Hi, I'm Ting Nguyen, and I'm with the Science Communication Lab. I'm so excited to talk to another presenter from our Share Your Research series today. We get to hear the voices of the different scientists. So today, I'm here with Lukas. Lukas, can you introduce yourself?
Absolutely. Hi, I'm Lukas Anneser. I'm a neuroscientist, and right now I'm working at the Friedrich Miescher Institute for Biomedical Research in Basel. My main focus of research is on the topic of neuromodulation, which is the question how brains cope with different environments and how they adapt to the different contexts we're in.
What got you interested in the brain?
Why am I interested in the brain? This started already at a very young age, actually in high school. In high school, I experienced a lesson on the nervous system, on the structure of the nervous system. And neurons have this very delicate morphology. They have a soma with the nucleus, and they have neurites, little arms that extend in all directions, and the axon, which is normally myelinated, which means there's just a sheet of lipids that is insulating this axon. And this was basically the lesson. And when I came home that day, my parents told me that a friend of the family, a watchmaker, had difficulty in his fine motor movements. And under the impression of what I just heard that day, I said, well, maybe it's a problem with the myelin sheath around his axons. And interestingly enough, that turned out to be correct. Like several months later, the medical doctors diagnosed him with a demyelination defect. And this was interesting to me in two different ways, because first, it showed me that based on my knowledge around the world, I can make valuable inferences. On the other side, in the context of diseases of the nervous system, it also showed me that there's not a lot we can do with that knowledge, because we hardly can cure anything. We can't cure Alzheimer's, we can't cure Parkinson's. It's really hard. And that ultimately inspired me to go into the basic research direction to understand how the nervous system is functioning in its normal state. After all, if you're a car mechanic and you don't understand how a car normally works, how are you supposed to fix it? I think the same is true for the brain, and that's why I'm trying to understand its basic functionality in animals.
And as you started doing research, I'm curious, what are some of the early scientific observations you made? And it could have been in the lab, or you sound like a really curious person in general. What about a scientific observation you've made?
Mm-hmm. Okay, let me start by one of the first findings I actually had. I started my career as a molecular biologist, and I still identify as a molecular biologist now in the context of neuroscience. But as a molecular biologist, you go into a lab and you work with tubes filled with liquids, transparent liquids, and you don't see anything. And one of the most interesting things about biology is you can actually make things visible that are normally only present as concepts. So in high school, you learn about DNA, about proteins. And one of the first experiments I actually did in a lab was a Western blot. A Western blot is a technique where you run proteins. You collect proteins from a tissue, and then you run them around a gel, and then you apply electricity, and you take all these proteins and you put them on a paper. And on this paper, you can then visualize them. And let's not talk about what I found there, but just about this concept of visualizing proteins, which is insane. We can actually make things visible that we normally just think about in very abstract terms. And this is a very empowering situation where you realize you can actually put your finger onto this abstract concept. You know it's actually real because you can visualize it, you can manipulate it, you can work with it. And this is what I really like about handling molecular biology.
Yeah, it really is quite incredible. And you can make things disappear, too. It's quite
you can do that as well. It's quite easy.
And so say, you know, we're speaking to the general audience here, but what if we're speaking to a young person who's interested in science, or maybe specifically going into molecular biology or neuroscience? What are some of the greatest things that you want them to know about the field?
I think one of the greatest things is really that the only thing that matters is the kind of ideas you have and how you want to implement them. The truth is that in the end, nobody really knows the answer to the questions we're posing. Like you normally think of professors as this all-knowing entity who just studied so much and knows everything. And that's true to a certain extent. But when you think about the questions we are actually asking in the lab, that's at the forefront of knowledge. And whatever you ask is probably not understood. So you can just really try and answer the questions you're interested in.
So this idea of discovery is really exciting.
Oh man, it is. At some point when you're in the lab and you run the experiment and you know you made a discovery because the results are just so striking. And at this very moment, you're the only person on the entire planet to really know this. It's a fact you discovered, and you're the only person who really knows that. And that's a really tremendous feeling.
It's true. I just got goosebumps when you were saying that. But let's be real too. The process of discovery that you're talking about, what's challenging about that? What should young people know about it? Everything.
Everything from the beginning to finish. I think the first problem is really to identify a question that is meaningful. Just because we don't know how something works doesn't mean it's worth studying. And so far, we don't really know how to identify good questions. We develop a feeling, like the more we do it, the more we feel about what is worth pushing for. But in the end, if we really knew what would be worth doing, there wouldn't be so many failed experiments. And there are a lot. So that's the beginning. And then you have to learn very difficult techniques, which are totally worth learning. But then again, it is a hard process. And I guess let's be real about this. A lot of these techniques are not really usable or applicable outside of a lab environment. You're probably at the forefront of knowledge, but that means that this knowledge is very, very defined in a sub-niche of a very particular field. So nobody else will care.
So it's all kind of building. It feeds your curiosity, but hopefully then it builds into something that, like you said, the basic underpinnings of the engine or of the body of human mm-hmm. health. And so as you're doing science, you've been thinking about science for a long time in a lot of different ways. What kinds of questions are you curious about in the world?
So one of the most interesting things to me is how our brain manages to cope with all the challenges that surround us. What I mean with this is that our brain is really good at lots of different things, but not at doing all of these things at once. So for example, you want to be in a certain state to, for example, play basketball. And this is certainly not the mental space you want to visit if you want to learn a poem or want to make your case in front of a jury. That's a different state of mind. And it's not clear how our brain can enter these different spaces and then enable particular kinds of behavior that just work better if you're in this particular state. And the regulation of these brain states, that's something I'm deeply curious about.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for talking with me today. I hope you all check out Lukas's video and his research, and he talks about neuromodulation and the way that he tests this out in the contexts, different very specific measurements, and he looks at social isolation. So thank you for watching. Thanks, Lukas.
Thanks a lot.